for joining us. I don't need that reminder. Let me just share this. Okay, my machine is now just completely given up. Camera on and my microphone. And remember that I am audio and sound. I'm going to keep an idea on the numbers. We've got 5 minutes to go. So we will start this in about 5 minutes' time. So go away, small screen thing. There we go. We can start about 5 minutes' time. There's a timer on your screen. So you have enough time. Let's see. You've got enough time to go grab a coffee if you're on the West Coast. I'm not sure what you're going to do here on the East Coast. And if you're in Europe, grab yourself a glass of wine, a beer, an adult beverage of your choice. And we will be back in about 4.5 minutes to start this session because we can see people just checking in. So bear with us. We'll be back in about 4.5 minutes. Jean, thank you very much for your help on the chat. Andy, nice to see you in the UK. Frank, how are you, sir? Okay, thanks very much for joining us. My name is Jerry Ratcliffe. I'm a professor of criminal justice here in Temple University, here in beautiful Philadelphia, where the sun is shining and it's not that chilly. Welcome to this session on OSCAR 1, the Kensington Transit Corridor Overdose Response Study. That's why we went with OSCAR 1, slightly shorter title that makes it a little bit more bearable. Online with us are a couple of the people who've been absolutely integral to what the video you're about to see. First and foremost is the Southeast Pennsylvania Transportation Authority Police Chief Tom Nestel, extremely qualified and experienced police officer from 7 or 8 decades worth of work in the Philadelphia area. thank you for joining us, Chief. Also online. Also online is Haley White, who is a graduate researcher in the Department of Criminal Justice at Temple University. Hello, Haley.
Hello.
Okay, so normally if this were just like a normal conference presentation, you would get a bunch of PowerPoint slides and we would go through some presentations and tell you a little bit about the project. It does originate with a Bureau of Justice Assistance grant to the Southeastern Pennsylvania Transportation Authority to look at how an improved, more rapid police response to overdoses in one of the largest drug markets around the transit system in one of the largest drug markets on the Eastern Seaboard, in fact, the largest open air drug market on the Eastern Seaboard, could be improved. I would go into it in more detail, but we decided to make a video out of this instead of going through some PowerPoint presentations. Nick Croft and Jennifer Wood and the organizers wanted to explore different mediums for the virtual, given the opportunity of a virtual conference in the marketplace of ideas. What you're about to see is the culmination of about 300 hours of ride-alongs with some video and some footage. So we have quotes from police officers, we have interviews with the chief, who was able in one take to not only drive a car and not crash, but actually really articulate very clearly a number of important details, as you're going to see in the video. I should also tell you the video is going to be publicly available down at the bottom. See, I've not uploaded it just yet. I'll do that after this conference presentation. jratcliffe.net/OSCAR1 is where you'll be able to access this video. So it won't just be for the conference, but after the conference, we'll be showing it. It's about 40 minutes long. It has a whole mix of things in it, as you'll see, a little bit of Pink Floyd, a little bit of a knife fight. The two main speaking roles are Haley White and myself are coming up with quotes from other people on the whole, but you're also going to see a whole chunk from Chief Tom Nestel, who is going to be available to answer questions afterwards, and from Jennifer Wood. Small plug to the Reducing Crime podcast, especially around policing and public health. The most recent episode of the Reducing Crime podcast, episode 32, featured the one and only conference organizer for this conference, Jennifer Wood. And if you roll the Wayback Machine all the way back to episode number one, that's about 2.5, 3 years ago, it features Tom Nestel. So if you want to hear a little bit more from Chief Nestel or from Jennifer Wood after seeing this video about their perspectives on a variety of things, please download and subscribe to the Reducing Crime podcast. I think I've covered everything I wanted to say before we actually going to jump into the video. Chief, anything to add?
No, sir. I'm looking forward to hearing the comments of folks and answering questions.
Good stuff. Haley, are we good?
We are good to go.
Okay, so what's going to happen, folks, is I'm going to stop sharing my screen. I'm actually going to put my video and mute off. What we're going to try and do is Haley is going to share the video. It lasts about 40 minutes long. And then we, the chief and I, will be available to answer questions or to deal with things that come up in the chat or the Q&A during this. And if there's anything that comes up that we see that we think is really interesting, we'll try and keep it back and deal with some questions afterwards. And with that, I'm going to hand it over to you, Haley. I'm just going to go off screen.
Great. I'm going to go ahead and share, turn off my mic and video. If I share the video and either audio or video aren't coming in, if someone could kind of just speak up and let me know, that'd be super helpful because I won't be able to see the chat or anything sharing my screen. So I'm going to go ahead and do that now.
Repeating, 24th, priority backup, 3000 Fuller Street, MAG 46. Have a large crowd of people and vehicles refusing to let them through.
24. Make this request from 441 and drop that.
I mean, I don't know what prompted it, but the opioid crisis in Philadelphia just exploded, and it was primarily along the Kensington Avenue corridor in a pretty small defined area in that neighborhood surrounding it. It just became a magnet for people from not just Philadelphia or surrounding suburbs, but from all over the country. And I've heard some people say that it was because of national television shows that were done about the Kensington Avenue corridor. That may very well be it. I've heard other people say that it's because of the quality of the drugs in Philadelphia. That might be it. But whatever caused it, it definitely exploded. It blossomed in the area. And of course, the symptoms of that problem became much larger and really started to interfere with the operation of mass transit in that area.
A recent feature published in the New York Times magazine goes inside Philadelphia's Kensington neighborhood. It's an area that's become synonymous with drug use. It's even earned the nickname the Walmart of heroin.
Kensington has a long history as a heroin epicenter. It's an area where those addicted to opioids come to buy and use.
But these neighborhoods are more commonly known in Philadelphia as the Badlands. And it's probably the largest open-air heroin market in the area, if not the East Coast.
The folks that are coming to buy and use drugs often aren't using a car to get here. They're using mass transit. So our officers were responding every day to overdose calls on buses and the elevated train. We equipped officers with Narcan and tried to expedite their response to those scenes to help the person who was having the overdose. So it got to a point where we needed to have some specialized function and a different strategy than just responding with Narcan.
Philadelphia is the sixth largest city in the US, with a population of over 1.5 million in the city itself and more than 4 million people in the greater metropolitan area. Located between New York and Washington, D.C., and just a couple of hours from both, the city is a cultural and economic center, the birthplace of American independence, and a thriving destination for history, dining, culture, and education. However, there is another side to Philadelphia. The city has a median household income one-third lower than the rest of the nation, and of the 10 largest cities in the country, Philadelphia has the highest poverty level. It is the only large city with a poverty rate greater than 20%, and 35% of the city's children live below the poverty line. One quarter of Philadelphia travels to work on public transport. With 9,000 employees, the Southeastern Pennsylvania Transportation Authority, known by the acronym SEPTA, is responsible for providing public transport to Philadelphia and the surrounding counties. SEPTA operates buses, trolleys, an extensive regional rail network, and two subway and elevated lines that altogether transport over 300 million passengers a year. Security across the system is provided by the 275 officers of the SEPTA Transit Police Department. While the department maintains specialized units such as canine and detectives, the majority of the officers are on uniform patrol in and around the transit system. A map of 2 years of overdose cases confirms the city's opioid problem is concentrated in the Kensington neighborhood. In particular, the challenges have been focused along the Kensington Avenue corridor in the stretch from Huntingdon to Allegheny Station. Somerset and Allegheny stations in particular have been ground zero for the opioid and fentanyl crisis. Straddling the north and lower northeast sections of Philadelphia and a 20-minute drive from the heart of the city, Kensington is a neighborhood with a storied history in Philadelphia. Named after an area of West London in the UK, the neighborhood of Kensington was founded in the early 1730s. A predominantly working-class neighborhood, over the years, Kensington transitioned from fishing and river work through iron and steel manufacture until deindustrialization took hold in the 1950s, with subsequent economic downturn and decline. In the last couple of years, some parts of Kensington have undergone regeneration and revitalization. New construction is cropping up in and around the area, drawn by the excellent transportation links and proximity to the center of Philadelphia. There are also vibrant communities in Kensington. Some of the police officers interviewed for this project recall going to local schools, and many people have long-standing links to the neighborhood. Ironically, though, the transportation links that should make living in Kensington attractive have also exacerbated the drug problem. Interstate 95, the main highway for the east coast of the United States running from the Canadian border all the way down to Florida, is only minutes away. It's not uncommon in Kensington to see license plates from New York and Virginia. There are also frequent bus services and an efficient rapid transit system running through the neighborhood centered on the L, the elevated Market Frankford train line.
The end result is that after buying the heroin and then using it, they're getting onto a train or a bus and they're overdosing, and that stops the system. So as you might imagine, in an elevated train system, when one train stops, everything stops on the line because it can't continue. It's not like you can go around a stop train.
The original project was designed to be a randomized trial of the effect of a dedicated transit police vehicle and officer responding to opioid overdoses. The police detail was given the radio call sign Oscar One.
Originally when we talked about how we could have an effect, we thought a faster response by transit police. So you put them in a mobile unit, you're able to monitor calls on Philadelphia Police Radio, Philadelphia Fire Radio, and SEPTA Transit Radio, and have those officers respond quickly to administer Narcan, to transport to the hospital, to offer social services, rehab opportunities, just have a faster response. things changed. You know, like the environment changed. And the environment changed because there were so many people dying of overdoses in Philadelphia that there was a concerted effort to have more than just the police and EMS and fire responding and providing Narcan. A huge effort by the Department of Health and social service agencies was initiated in getting the public involved. So what we started to see was that the public was administering Narcan before we even arrived. So it changed our grant program completely.
The appropriate use of Narcan nasal spray can help reverse an overdose. Remove Narcan nasal spray from the box. Hold the Narcan nasal spray with your thumb on the bottom of the plunger and your first and middle fingers on either side of the nozzle. Press the plunger firmly to give the full dose of Narcan nasal spray.
So some of the problems that came up were COVID, naturally. I mean, COVID just changed the entire method by which we were dealing with the vulnerable community.
100,000 lives lost to coronavirus. That tragic toll is now reality in America.
Well, tonight, as the U.S. marks the deaths of more than 400,000 Americans from COVID, mutations of the virus are rapidly popping up across the country.
And civil disorder, which drew our resources away, and delays in the release of funding. You know, all of these things changed the program that we envisioned in the beginning. I think it's an opportunity now to look at how policing can be a bigger part in helping to address the vulnerable community.
We don't spend nearly enough time as we should listening to line officers, right? In terms of the demands placed on them, the pressures, the lack of tools, the lack of resources, you know, what they need to do their job better, what they see are the most pressing issues in the communities that they serve. We need their voice in the conversation. And we haven't been, you know, we collectively haven't done this very well.
The police, the frontline workers, can be a part of that rehabilitation and that treatment, the connection of social services. And that's what we're envisioning now here at SEPTA with the SAVE unit, using officers who have an interest in this type of work to connect the vulnerable population with what they need.
A number of SEPTA police officers have new partners tonight, and they're not other SEPTA police officers. They're social workers. Action News reporter Chris Dialetto is live in Center City, Philadelphia. Christy, a different kind of pairing. What is its purpose?
Well, Jim, this is one of the hubs that they're stationed at, and the goal is to help those lingering, if not living, in these mass transit centers get the help that they need.
So we were here twice today.
SEPTA Police Officer Gabriella Fenwick and Mirahi Outreach Specialist Nicole Pollitt are a team.
This is Officer Fenny. We're just out here just checking on people.
It's part of a new pilot program with the Mass Transit Agency, who's added addiction and mental health specialists as the nation debates what the future of policing looks like.
The pandemic is causing more poverty, more mental health issues. They're attracted to mass transit, you know, because it's a safe place for people who are vulnerable to be.
Right now, a handful of teams are stationed at the Center City and Kensington SEPTA hubs.
You guys looking to get shelter?
Down in Center City, a lot of the problems are more centered around homelessness. When we're up in Kensington, the focus is more on Narcan distribution.
Over the last 2 weeks, the team has made over 100 contacts in addressing needs for those congregating at SEPTA stops.
And while this pilot program has only been in place for the last 2 weeks, the goal essentially is to get more of these teams stationed at different SEPTA stops across the city.
As a professor in the Department of Criminal Justice at Temple University here in Philadelphia, I was asked to evaluate the project. With graduate researcher Haley White, we conducted dozens of ride-alongs comprising over 300 hours of field observations.
We rode with the officers on OSCAR 1 frequently for a number of months during the project to enable them to give us their perspectives freely and honestly. We gave them anonymity. So we copied down their quotes, but for the purposes of the video, what the officer said will be read here by Haley White and myself.
There are two types of harm reduction measure that are frequently encountered in Kensington. One is specific material support for safer drug use, such as the provision of clean needles to reduce infection risk, needle disposal boxes, and the wide availability of Narcan. The second involves a more general type of support, such as public sinks and the activities of community groups providing clothing, blankets, and food to the street community. The complexity of providing clean needles and Narcan was not lost on the officers. They frequently recognized the health benefits, but also directly encountered negative consequences.
So, policing in that area, officers can exercise their discretion in different ways. And as one officer said, there were needles everywhere. That's my thing. I don't care about smoking on the platform, but all the needles, leaving them everywhere, I hate that. My mom takes the train and I worry about her safety with all the needles everywhere.
The widespread availability of Narcan had made the officers' lives easier and was widely, though not universally, supported. We also encountered multiple times when people did not want their friends to receive Narcan, even though they were in a life-threatening situation. We've watched people become combative because the Narcan has brought them out of their high.
During my time with one of the officers, we talked about the addicted population's attitude towards Narcan and how they don't want it to be administered and ruin their high. He said, I'll wake someone up. Well, if they're able to be woken up, if they can't really stand up, I'll say, hey, I'll give you Narcan, and they'll say no, because they don't want to ruin their $5 high.
The challenges of finding the right balance between providing harm reduction assistance and enabling continuing in harmful activity was recognized not just by police officers, but also by people involved in rehabilitation treatment.
There's a fine line you walk between being compassionate and then enabling someone to continue living that life. And don't get me wrong, people, especially in times like this with the weather, like it's cold, man. People need to, and if somebody's not alive, ain't nobody getting sober. Dead people don't get sober. So that's why I'm kind of like in a weird spot, because I'm in support of harm reduction and all of those things. But I also think there's a balancing act. Like there's a community down in Kensington that deserves the same amount of support that we're giving the folks that are living in that community, you know? And I think there's a balancing act there that's going to be, that's the challenge. Like, how do you balance that? You take care of the community and the folks that are trying to raise their kids and get their kids to school safely while also trying to deal with the scourge of the addiction and all of the fentanyl and stuff.
I attended one call with the Oscar 1 officer where a man was breathing, but he was unresponsive. He had a friend with him, but his friend said that he didn't like to give Narcan unless he really, really, really needed it, because they wake up and hate everybody.
The majority of officers did not feel that there was a lack of support available for rehabilitation in the city. Rather, it was a lack of willingness to engage with the process.
There is so much help in Philly. Now, granted, with COVID, people tell me you can't get a bed, but there's plenty of recovery houses. But they just got to follow rules, and many of them don't want to follow rules, so it's just easier to be out here.
Outreach workers did confirm to us that although it requires making numerous phone calls and transport, it's always been possible to get someone into a rehab facility on the same day. While not directly supporting drug use, most of the officers felt that groups who provided support such as blankets, clothing, food and drink were not helping or making a positive contribution to the area.
They, meaning folks on the street, have everything they need. They can get clothing, food, housing. People that bring food and clothing here, the churches, they are not helping. They are doing it to make themselves feel better.
With rare exceptions, support groups were seen as enablers who reduced incentives to get off the streets.
One officer summarized enablers as people who come and give food and clothing, which makes them comfortable because they get everything they need. Another officer complained, groups bringing clothing and food to people who are homeless, you are helping sustain the cause of addiction. You are a catering service.
Overall, officers were supportive of outreach workers, specialized groups like Prevention Point and Meraki, who provide shelter, addiction rehabilitation, and mental health support. They were not supportive of charities and church groups that provided general logistic support. The provision of food and clothing was seen as enabling a negative lifestyle and actively supporting the continuation of people living on the street.
As one officer summarized, the enablers make my job 10 times harder.
Yeah, the homeless community in Philadelphia is no different than any other cities. It's people suffering from poverty, drug addiction, alcohol addiction, and mental health problems. You know, it's the makeup of the vulnerable community. And we as the police have to figure out a way to have a sustained result instead of just these short-term solutions that don't give us real benefit.
That we ask police to do so much. We ask them to solve social problems. We ask them to address issues of chronic vulnerability. They are a frontline, sort of full service social agency. We place great demands on them, and we haven't supported them in that enterprise, right? So we've set them out into the world to address issues that we haven't given them the infrastructure to support them.
You know, an example is every night the SEPTA system shuts down, it closes. And we have to remove people who have come to SEPTA because it's safe, it's out of the weather, it's warm in the winter and cool in the summer. You know, it's their shelter. And we have to remove them every night, and there's no, you know, there's no sustained result to try to reduce that problem. So I think that policing and social services joining together to have a sustained effort in actually helping to reduce homelessness is a good path for all of us to take.
Officers had a range of views about the addicted population, a population in which they regularly came in contact. Most were neutral or expressed sympathetic and compassionate attitudes for people with addictions, but this was not universally the case.
One officer said, "It's hard to sympathize because I can't imagine being in their shoes because I would never allow myself to get like that." Another officer commented, "There are good people around and they are just stuck in their habit, but it's like a needle in a haystack trying to find a genuinely good person."
Officers come into contact with people with addictions in a number of ways. Vulnerable populations are drawn to the transit system because it's safer than the surrounding neighborhoods. The officers have to keep the entrances to the station clear for fare-paying customers and deal with overdoses and disturbances on transit property. A number of the officers felt that some people chose to be on the street, but they also recognized that, as one officer said, "Most people don't want to be out here laying in their own vomit, wearing the same thing day in and day out." Another said, "They're all decent people out here, just got caught up with addiction. Nurses, roofers, they had good jobs. See that guy right there? He's been out here for 10 years. When you stop seeing them, you just assume they're dead." Many of the officers grew up in Philadelphia, and some are from the Kensington area. Some of the officers had personal experiences of the drug situation. One officer said, "My own brother is out here. I haven't seen him in years. Last I checked, he was doing good, though."
Another said, "I work in rehab in my spare time. I've seen people come into rehab and turn around and detox and rehab and go on to have beautiful lives, and I've been sober for 10 years. A number of officers were concerned about how frequently they saw women, often young women, on the street. One officer noted, "A lot of them were raped by uncles, fathers. It's a way to cope. They want to escape from their body."
Hello, ma'am, you all right?
Yeah, thank you,
officer. Okay. And she's pregnant.
That trauma has its impact. Another officer said, "A lot of them don't want no help. They definitely don't want help from the police."
Brick up that.
Yeah.
Whatever. They had like a little hut up there. So there's some of them right here. You okay, buddy? You all right? Miss, you good? Girl out here all by herself.
Mm.
No, she's just, there's all these rats around here. See them all?
Yeah.
And she's just laying there by herself. It's nasty.
Yeah. You know, there's a big difference between transit police and city police, you know, township police, county police. Most police officers are assigned to a car and they're driving around in their areas of responsibility. Having contact with people when they get to a call. The transit police are on foot, riding the system in stations where there's a constant flow of people, engaging customers, riders, the public on a daily basis, and they become really good at communicating.
Did you yell my name?
You better double pick. I think
you can get there.
She's not about to have me. McKenna.
McKenna.
Oh, like a dummy. That's nutty.
I didn't hear you.
I was like, "Oh, man, that's good. I'm really in the church."
One officer said to me, "There's a rock song with the lyrics Comfortably Numb." And I said, "Pink Floyd?" And he replied, "Yes. I'm not sure that's what the lyrics were referring to, but people out here are comfortably numb."
Is there anyone home? Come on, come down. I hear you're feeling down. Well, I can ease your pain, get you on your feet again. There is no pain you are receiving. A distant ship smoke. Just
first with a warp into the bottom of the bin.
Don't talk about it.
Yeah, black jacket with yellow in it. The mask, arm with the knife, on the front.
6 bombing, just on the loop. Have everyone use caution.
Are you guys use caution?
As one officer said, Kensington was never a nice area. Anyone who tells you that's lying, but it was safer.
So I always wondered why folks were kind of wandering about after using drugs when they clearly are nodding in and out of consciousness, which includes nodding into traffic. There is a huge fear of being victimized. And while, to me, walking around while you're dipping in and out of consciousness is a safety issue, it's actually a safety issue to stay stationary as well, because they are extremely vulnerable in that state, and walking around might be the lesser of two evils.
The officers expressed frustration at having to implement city policy they saw as well-intentioned, but naive. Elected politicians in Philadelphia have clearly signaled that they do not want officers arresting drug users.
Philadelphia District Attorney Larry Krasner says the city is working on a plan to decriminalize drug possession. In an interview with Axios on HBO, Krasner says that his office is trying to get more drug users into treatment rather than behind bars. While no formal diversion policy is in the works just yet, Krasner says that his office is very close to developing ways to increase the use of treatment programs.
So we are talking about people who are using drugs, the vast majority of them suffering from addiction. I do not see value in convicting people like that.
Officers generally told us that approach, accompanied with the provision of free needles and other support for drug use, has almost inevitably led to flagrant open drug injection along Kensington Avenue.
When you drive down Kensington Avenue and around McPherson Park in the morning, or when everybody has been re-upped, you can easily witness 20 to 30 people injecting drugs in just 5 or 6 blocks.
The officers we worked with expressed frustration because they felt the city's approach resulted in the officers having to bear the brunt of public anger at what they saw as police inaction and a subsequent public health crisis.
On a number of field observations, we encountered members of the public complaining to officers about the community and their children having to witness open drug injection and navigate streets strewn with discarded used needles and other drug paraphernalia.
I think she should have done.
At least check some.
Right.
It's on me. Right. Are you running your ticket down? Do you know
that the DA's office will not prosecute somebody using drugs?
I don't talk about that. I'm a drug addict.
But we do. We do. I mean, so us approaching it, you know, this is another issue that's changed how we handle things, is that the justice system has changed in society's choice of who runs justice, who that district attorney is, and what that district attorney's views on how justice will be administered. And we've seen a change in Philadelphia. And we as the police have to adapt to those changes, not fight them. So, you know, if you have a district attorney who is not going to support arresting people for possession of narcotics, then we have to find other alternatives. You know, we just have to have those resources available to us. It can't be, yes, police, go ahead and solve that problem, but we don't have rehabs and we don't have crisis response centers for mental health subjects, and you know, we don't have social services for poverty and jobs and education. All of those things have to be tied in with policing.
Each time I've worked Oscar One with a female officer, some of the folks that we interact with behave differently than they do when I'm with a male officer. When people see two women in the vehicle, they often act in an overtly playful way. And this has ranged from comments on our appearance when we exit the vehicle. Teenage boys have made kissing faces at us from outside of the vehicle's window. General flirtatious commentary gets thrown at us. This kind of behavior does not happen when I'm accompanied by a male officer. One female officer attributes this behavior to the public perceiving female officers as being weaker than male officers, and this emboldens them to act out.
This ain't no job.
No, it's not. Oh, buy a coat. That's probably cold already.
No, I just got it.
Oh. Well, go, you're shaking.
What's his story?
No, he just hangs out here. So he usually helps us out, like, clearing the station.
What's he get out of it?
Nothing. I think he just has a crush on me, so.
In one case, the Oscar One officer assisted with a man who had died overnight, most likely from an overdose. And in one rather more dramatic situation, we were present when an assault occurred. The Oscar One officer and I were at Allegheny Station talking to another officer when a bloke came stumbling down the station steps shouting that people were stabbing each other. And he wasn't wrong. Fortunately, nobody was seriously hurt, and the men were given medical treatment on scene and at hospital. But the presence of enough officers to handle the situation may have prevented more serious injury.
The problems with society are a lot less with crime and more with addiction and poverty and mental health issues. And all of those things have landed in the lap of policing over the past decades. And I don't know that we were well equipped or very good at addressing those problems then. I think that the future has a different vision for policing and us being an integral part in helping with society's problems, not through arrest. As he injects him in the neck. Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable.
Vulnerable people are drawn to the transit system because it provides shelter and safety. However, it also brings issues of drug use and disorder into the everyday life of transit passengers and local residents. The transit officers we observed strive to balance conflicting priorities related to the fundamental tension that exists in 21st century policing. Should the police role be focused on just reducing and preventing crime, or include aiding in the provision of community safety and security? While police officers may not be everyone's first choice in providing harm reduction assistance, they are in the area 24/7, have accountability and a capacity to respond quickly, have a public service ethos, and have often fostered relationships with the vulnerable people who inhabit the transit system space.
Since the summer, at least in Philadelphia, and then certainly earlier in other places, there's been a lot of conversation about what the police should be doing and what whether or not it's worth continuing to dedicate public dollars to the policing effort, and I think that they're the best way is to have a combination, you know, where funding is still going to the police, but providing them with the opportunity to provide the services that they weren't able to provide before. So, you know, an example is our SAVE unit, Serving a vulnerable entity is what it stands for. And we have officers that are specially trained through a private entity, the Marquee Corporation, which does drug rehab work and social service work. To be able to fund that type of partnership, because, you know, getting rid of the police just doesn't seem realistic to me. And sure, I'm a cop, so why would it seem realistic to me? But when somebody's in danger, they want a police officer to come and help them, and the police want to provide that service. So if you still maintain the police and continue with that level of service, but also provide them model, and it provides a security element for the folks that are having direct contact with people in need. I think that's a great look for the future.
Because they're on foot and often permanently posted to specific stations, they build connections with the local community, who are often struggling with comorbidity issues around physical and mental health, drug addiction, trauma, safety, and homelessness. They are de facto street social workers. And regardless of their conflicting views or personal ideologies, over the months, we never saw them behave in anything other than a professional and courteous manner. And that is even when they share the same frustrations as many Kensington residents, that there is either a lack of quality rehab treatment available, or people do not want or are not capable of taking advantage of that help. Inevitably, being embedded in the situation every day, some officers have become, or are concerned about becoming, desensitized to the daily misery. Overwhelmed by the number of drug users, they have to balance checking in on people who may be overdosing with their responsibilities to station safety and the surrounding areas. And this is sometimes determined by their personal perspectives on the level of choice exercised by people on the street. Officers generally feel there is a role for enforcement as a way to combat the more egregious problems, yet they feel their hands are tied by city policies and regional public attitudes that they had no hand in crafting. The situation in Kensington did not magically appear overnight, but is the result of economics, policies, and deindustrialization that's been happening since the 1950s. In much the same way, the future will be determined by funding priorities, decisions about what can and will or will not be enforced and prosecuted, and public tolerance to the social impacts of drug activity. In the meantime, the proximity of police departments to both the vulnerable community as well as those involved in the drug business would suggest that it is prudent to keep police integral to conversations about addressing local crime and public health challenges.
Oh. 401 on location, last 3022.
130.
WPRW 570, 5 p.m. 130, if you have free time, we'll call back around whoever 19 is at work.
Okay, Haley, thank you very much for sharing your screen. Okay, ladies and gents, we have a little bit of time left. Can't believe some people just joined us at the end of the video there for us. You missed all the good bits. Welcome back. I'm going to open up the, I'm going to throw to Haley and Tom Nestel in just a moment. I will just say a few things. So first of all, thanks very much for sitting through our 40-minute video when the conference organizers said they we're open to the idea of different media. I probably got a little overexcited. So this is our entry for a Razzie. I think this is the opposite of the Oscars. For those of you who work in this environment, I should have said that you probably saw a lot of stuff that you were familiar with. I know former Chief Ron Teachman came up in the chat saying it reminded him of work that he was doing 40 years ago, which made me sad that not a lot has changed. And thanks for that comment, Tom. Ron, but yeah, so for a lot of you who work in the area, it's probably a bunch of things that you have already experienced, and there was some of it that probably wasn't very new to you. However, what we hope is that the video is an opportunity to reach to different audiences, certainly in the Philadelphia region, so that we can draw attention to the problem and get a little bit more focus on the problem. So please bear with us with that in mind. There is a better quality video. We lost Tom and Estelle for a moment there. It's going to be on YouTube. I'm going to open up the link. As soon as we finish this session, I'll go online and make the video public. Details can be found through jratcliffe.net/Oscar-1, and I'll be posting it on Twitter in about 20 minutes. And just before we open up to any other questions, I'm going to throw Chief, you, that's the first time you've seen the video since you saw some earlier drafts. Anything you want to add for the folk who've been watching?
No, well, I hope they felt the same way I did. I thought it was really a powerful piece. And you and Haley did a fantastic job of really capturing the essence of the Kensington Avenue corridor. And that's a difficult thing to capture. You know, I mean, most people who drive down that corridor think it's a movie set because it just isn't real. You know, kudos to both of you. What a tremendous video piece that really sends a message and tells a great story. And, you know, one of the comments in the chat was that the anonymous comments were negative by the police. And I think it's important to recognize that everybody doesn't think this is a good idea. You know, I mean, police officers, they are like every other part of society. Change doesn't come easily or happily. And when some folks become a police officer, they think that they're going to be running and gunning all day and not talking and or walking and talking. You know, the walking and talking is the important piece. And the folks that are assigned to this function are assigned specifically because they're good at that. You know, they have a passion to provide that kind of service. And would I like to see the entire police department function that way? Sure. Will more join in as it goes along? They have. You know, and you hear officers who now come in contact with somebody that's looking for help, now calling for our social service teams. So I think that progress is occurring. But I also think that this is, you know, something new for policing. And we need to have the backdrop of services available so that these officers can succeed in providing what they're doing for folks.
Thank you. And you're absolutely right. And I'm actually glad to Autumn's comment that came up in the chat that some of that came across. Because if there are 800,000 police officers across the United States, there's just no way there's a homogeneity of thought. And so the fact that you were experiencing that people have got different perspectives actually came across in the video, yes, I think is a good thing, because we have to win people over if we think that this is the right thing to do. And it's good that there are a range of views. That's always good for us. Haley, your thoughts. Because you sat in the wagon as much as I did, if actually a bit more than I did.
Yeah, so I think what these findings kind of add is a really crucial piece on the reality of executing some of the harm reduction tools that are becoming available to police. Chief Nestel mentions it. Jerry, I believe you make a few comments in the video about the proximity of police to a lot of vulnerable communities and the reality of things landing in the lap of policing. And there's kind of been an expanded toolkit that's come with that, which includes the distribution of Narcan, not just to folks in the community, but also police officers have almost an endless supply available. And also with SEPTA specifically, we have pretty direct referral to treatment if needed. So officers have this expanded toolkit, but the reality of executing those tools is quite complicated. So what I talked about in the video, kind of with folks having hesitancy to receiving Narcan, that's a reality because Narcan sends folks into rapid withdrawal. And the Most of the information about Narcan that's available in the literature and everything kind of talks about how it's, you know, the overdose antidote. It's great. We see charts about declining overdose deaths, but the reality is that some overdoses and deaths may persist because of the kind of negative health consequences, or at least symptomatic consequences of receiving Narcan and going into withdrawal, as well as trying to funnel folks into longer term treatments. So engaging with folks is, you know, pretty easy and can come pretty readily, but following through with folks to kind of get them into those longer term treatment options is quite difficult. So I think this added a crucial piece about the reality of those things on the ground.
Yeah, thank you. And yes, you're absolutely right about Narcan. It's worth pointing out that like there's a tendency, especially amongst the public outside of this knowledgeable audience that we have on the chat, there's a tendency from the public to think of every tool in a very simplistic fashion. Narcan works, or tasers work, or body-worn cameras work. And it's much more complicated that they work sometimes, and then they sometimes work in ways that you weren't anticipating and didn't think about. We have a couple of questions. I'm gonna jump in and answer one, and then Chief, if you're still on, I'm gonna come back to you for one. We have a question from Jean out in Region 3. I keep saying it really is the best question. Do you have peers in the department, officers that have experienced substance use disorder and are in recovery? Yes, there was one that we actually quoted in the video for an anonymity. I'm not saying who it was, but there was one that actually was one of the quotes that Haley read. But Chief, I'm going to come to you for two of the questions. I'm going to give you one at a time. Jackie has a question I know from the UK. She's a superintendent from the UK, one of the quick movers coming up through the organization in the UK from British policing. She's saying that in the UK, they're starting to join up the engagement and enforcement work of the serious violence and the violence reduction units in terms of working alongside. So trying to bring, I'm just going to paraphrase a little bit here and just, I hope I get this right, Jackie, figure out how to dovetail the enforcement arm, the best way to use enforcement alongside the social service provision.
Yeah, that's a tricky element because we're trying very hard to change the mindset of the vulnerable community in convincing them that we're there to help as opposed to arrest them. So right now we're very focused on, as a matter of fact, I mean, at one point when we started this, some of the social service folks that were guiding our initiative said, you can't have uniformed police officers in a marked vehicle doing this kind of work and be successful. And I pushed back because I want people to have a different view of the police. And if they don't know we're the police, then we're not changing that view. We may be helping people, but we're not changing the view of the police. So that's an important element. I think that, you know, luckily for us, our narcotics enforcement is limited to making buys in stations and tracking down suppliers that are using our stations as hubs for drug sales. And because we have the resources and the time, we can go after those low-level dealers that are selling at our stations and you know, do search warrants and make arrests and have a quick positive effect that you might not ordinarily have with the city resources because they're prioritizing. So I think that we push away the drug element, the drug sale element, maybe a half a block, you know, so it's not in the station, but it's a half a block away. So the enforcement integration with the social service assistance hasn't come to fruition yet because we're still working on convincing the patients, the clients, that we're there to help them, not arrest them.
Great, thank you. And I think that's the important part, that there's a lot of issues around trust and legitimacy in the environment that really need to be worked on. This is a big step in that direction. The other question comes from, and in hindsight, I should have thought about this, putting Haley out in the wagon with you, but Jackie asks, what support do the officers have from getting to see this trauma every shift? I suppose that's coming your direction, Chief. It's I mean, you've worked in a variety of environments, but Kensington's got to be up there in terms of, I mean, it's not Upper Moreland, which is in the Philadelphia suburbs where you were a chief for a number of years.
Yeah. You know, I think that the benefit of this program is that we're using officers that volunteer. And those officers have a different mindset than the folks that if you drafted somebody. So they're already in a good place mentally, where they're able to deal with some of the issues that if you were forced to join the unit, you might not be as good at addressing. But we have recognized that our folks are constantly being put into traumatic scenarios, just dealing with a very vulnerable population that is suffering from substance abuse, violence. But along with this, we have a number of suicides that occur on our system, and our officers are constantly handling those issues. So we've trained officers, again, folks that have volunteered to become part of a peer assistance group. And we mobilize that peer assistance group pretty frequently to send them out and talk to officers in the field and just make sure that everybody's in the right place. And if they're not, we're going to get them help.
And in the chat, Gene asked about compassion fatigue. And Gene, I'll just say that is something that we actually addressed close to the end of the video, where the officers were concerned about getting to that level. Okay, there is one more question I'm going to answer, then I'm going to wrap up this session. It's from Kevin Hall asking about the evaluation. Kevin, the evaluation has changed. As we said in the video, it was designed to be a randomized trial. While we're still doing randomization, the numbers are probably not going to elicit much in terms of quantitative feedback to us, because the project changed over terms of the project lifestyle. When Chief Nestel originally conceptualized the project, this really is his baby and his brainchild, the number of overdoses in the transit system was just off the charts. But as he said in the video, what's been great is that the city has moved this entire effort forward. So now everybody in the air, a lot of people in the area carry Narcan. I carry Narcan. I know Haley carries Narcan. Everybody in the area carries Narcan. So the numbers are down. So we probably won't have much of a quantitative evaluation. But let me just wrap up this session by saying what we plan to do late spring, hopefully into early summer, not because it'll take longer, but because I would like summer to get here a damn sight sooner, for Haley and I is to actually write a couple of journal articles going through and identifying more of the qualitative work that we've been doing and putting that. And as soon as we have the drafts of that, or as soon as we get those out in the realm of publication, we will update them. So for updates on this project, I would point everybody in the direction of jratcliffe, that's my name, .net/Oscar1, where I will publish updates to this project over the next month or year, just that there's new stuff coming out. And I'm sure people will be happy to follow the chief on Twitter. And let's see if I can share my screen with your Twitter name on it. See if I can find, give me a second, here we go. And here we go, up at the top. So you can follow Chief Nestel at TNestel3. You can follow Haley White at Haley White, and I'm Jerry_Ratcliffe. If you would prefer to follow a college basketball writer from Virginia, then take out the underscore. He's fascinating and has a bunch more followers than I do. Other than that, follow us for updates. We'll try and remember to post updates with the hashtag Oscar1, all one word. And other than that, thank you very much for joining us. And you have a few minutes before, 5 minutes before the next session. So I'll leave Sarah to shut that down. Haley, any last comments? You good?
I'm good.
Chief?
I'm good, and thank you for everybody that came to watch and listen.
Okay, great. Thanks very much, everybody. Take care. Bye-bye.